All right. Welcome, everybody, to the Budget Committee, Thursday, August 13th. We will call this meeting to order. We will start with roll call, which Phyllis has already. And we'll move on to item number three, committee discussion of the budget, which we'll start with Planning and Protective Services. Ms. McMillan will lead us through that and go over the highlights, and we'll be there to answer any questions. It's all yours.
Thank you. Thank you. The Department of Planning and Protective Services represents about $2.1 million of the general fund. We also represent and administer several grants, the MPO Transportation Planning Grant, CDBG Entitlement, and various state grants. The department supports about half of the city's boards and commissions, and we have six divisions. And we'll be going over those budgets this evening. It's a fairly small department, only 18 full-time staff, 3 part-time staff. In the 520 PPS administration budget, really no significant changes there. Probably the most notable thing is that gas for the entire department is in that division budget, and the administration division administers the hearings for nuisances, junked vehicle violations, and vicious animals.
Okay, is there any questions for Ms. Millen on the which section is this?
520. 520 PPS administration. I don't know what tab that's in.
Thank you. Can you explain a little bit on the increase on the counseling services for 5-year update to the Metropolitan Transportation Plan?
Sure. That's in budget 522 MPO. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. The next section is 521, planning, and no significant changes there either. That division supports the Planning and Zoning Commission Board of Adjustment and is responsible for administration of the sign code and sign permits. That's one full-time person and one part-time person.
Any questions? Mr. Scudder?
Is this the... Are you looking to add people in this?
In 522, under that's in the MPO section.
Okay, not 521, under
correct.
522. Okay.
Yeah. Any other questions? Councilman Stallis?
Yes. I'm reading this across right, under professional services, there's $125,000 there.
Mm-hmm,
what's that for?
That is in 522 MPO. Yes, next section.
Okay. Councilman Scribner.
I do have a question. I started to interrupt and ask, or not interrupt, but try to catch. On the administration, I noticed there's a $4,000 reduction in expense. But as I look down through, I don't see anything really standing out. How with salary increases and so forth, or projected salary increases,
just reductions in various line items,
just
really.
Just a little here and there.
Just a little here and there.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions? Seeing none, we'll move on to the next section.
Okay. 522. That's the one we're all itching to get to. Okay. The Metropolitan Planning Organization. The MPO administers the consolidated planning grant that we receive for metropolitan transportation planning for the Jefferson City urbanized area, and that's a regional planning program that consists of multiple cities and multiple counties, Callaway County, Cole County, the cities in the urbanized area. There are the MPO budget process really goes through the board of directors, and they prepare and recommend a budget to the council. And the UPWP and budget are then sent to MoDOT. MoDOT prepares the planning grant agreements that come back around for approval by the city council. So changes this year in terms of program and budget. The MPO planning area was expanded this year as a result of it actually started with the 2010 census. Wardsville and Taos were included in our area. As a result, there were changes in the MOU and bylaws that became effective this year. They were ratified by the participating jurisdictions. The planning process review made some recommendations. We're supposed to have one of those every 3 years, where Federal Transit Administration, Federal Highway Administration, and MoDOT review the planning program and make recommendations. Also recognize the staff for any commendable actions and programs they may have completed in the prior 3 years. So there were the planning process review was completed early this year. There were 8 commendations, one of which was the staff's efforts on outreach and public involvement, which foster livable communities, which is one of the important planning goals for all of us, really, and is mirrored in the federal laws. They also offered 7 recommendations, 2 of which are represented by the pink sheets in this division. One of those is to include more projects in the Metropolitan Transportation Plan and Transportation Improvement Program. Projects that are in those documents are also reflected many times in the city's capital improvement program. And the second suggestion was to add staffing to support comprehensive planning, transportation planning, and transit planning for the area. So the pink sheets that were included in the budget request this year reflect those recommendations. So in one case, there was a pink sheet to add professional services. That begins the update of the Metropolitan Transportation Plan that we're required to update every 5 years. We also began what's called a travel demand model. We hire an engineering consultant to examine the travel patterns in the region and update the computer model that reflects what the future travel demands for all of the transportation systems. And then the other pink sheet represents the hiring of one additional planner. And both of those are proposed to be funded by 80% grant funds. And then there was one unfunded, one pink sheet that was left unfunded, and that one was to keep the level of public involvement going that we've achieved with the wayfinding plan and that we've started with our bicycle pedestrian plan. The two pink sheets for the professional services and the mid-level planner would be funded by a combination of STP grant funds. The other pink sheet on the public involvement addition would be funded by the consolidated planning grant.
So if I could just add the overall addition with the grant fund piece, then is
12,710. The total amount on the professional services, it was $125,000, and that's 80% grant funded. Yeah. And the mid-level planner, we estimate the total salary and benefits would be about $63,000, so that'd be 80% funded, grant funded also. So the local match on that was $13,000. The benefit of that not only would be to assist with the city's and the region's comprehensive planning, transit planning, project identification for the MTP, and Metropolitan Transportation Plan. And those projects also get translated into the city's capital improvement program. So one of the comments that our reviewers made this year was there need to be more project-specific more projects specifically identified in the MTP. And so that, by doing this advanced planning, that gets those projects into the MTP, and then those can move forward into the CIP. And then the other part of that program is to help support the overall general comprehensive planning effort. If you recall, last year one of my pink sheets was to was proposing an update of the city's comprehensive plan. Updating a comprehensive plan is a fairly significant effort. It really goes those projects run over a period of years, and they're very expensive projects. So this was an alternative to hiring a consultant that might cost $300,000 or $400,000 to update a comprehensive plan, and in turn use some available grant funds to hire a position to focus on that effort on a continuing basis, as well as work on the five-year MTP, because there's so much overlap between those plans. We thought it would be a good proposal to make, and an economical one.
Councilman Scriver.
I want to make sure that I'm, because I've said this a few times, and I want to make sure that I'm correct on this MPO consultant services. Doing that plan update, I mean, if we're going to be a CAMPO organization, part of an organization, and we're going to expect to receive funds from the federal government, we have to have that plan. There's no option as far as doing it or not doing it if we're going to continue to function as a CAMPO. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So in some ways, we have no option. I mean, we could not do it, but we can't do it, or can't not do it.
Right. Well, one of the things we don't want to do is wait till the last minute to start, and then we're under the gun to finish it, and then, you know, it's just not a good way to administer the program. So we want to start early so that we can get those plans, get the base data taken care of, so that we can use that for good program planning, so that we can identify projects to include in the next Metropolitan Transportation.
And did plan. We or did we not include, I mean, we may have gotten the horse a little bit before the cart, but we recently approved a CAMPO planning document, and I think that this update of this Metropolitan plan, this MTP, was in that document that we've already approved, was it not?
Yes, the board approved that, and also the public involvement section that was not included in that didn't get moved forward. So we have two options on that part. We can request the city to add the $1,750. We requested $2,500 total in advertising and public involvement. I think the city's portion of that would be about
$250, I think it says here.
Right. So we requested that if the city is not willing to fund that, we can go back to the board and ask them to revise the budget, and they could still fund that advertising and public involvement if they wanted to reduce one of their other budget categories. But we'll have to do that next week, because the other kind of a time crunch that we're on in this particular program is that we have to request our planning grant agreement from MoDOT this month. So whatever is approved needs to be requested from MoDOT so that planning grant agreement can come back to the council for approval in September. Because then once the council approves it, then it can go on to the commission.
You said we can do that next week. You talking about CAMPO can do that
next
week?
Yes, CAMPO. If that public involvement is not supported by the city council, then we'll ask CAMPO to revise their budget.
Okay. And in regard to the planner, the MPO planner too, was that also included in that planning document that
yes.
I was thinking that it was. So in essence, we've already, like I say, maybe we got the cart before the horse, but we've already in essence said that we're going to approve these.
Mm-hmm. The board of directors proposed this budget to the city council, so now it's really in the council's lap.
So we still have the final option of saying
yes.
No.
Everyone has to agree.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Councilman Mihaljevic.
And as I understand it, kind of a bonus to this is we get a comprehensive plan out of the deal. And when was the last time the comprehensive plan was updated?
Well, we try to update the land use map when we do a rezoning, but the last real overhaul and updating of the sections occurred in 1996. Although we have updated portions of it, mm-hmm. but just not the overall document.
Well, my observation is that as a request comes to the P&Z, a high mark should be whether they're going to revise the comprehensive plan or not. And it got to be the point where about every request was revising the comprehensive plan. So that told me that it's overdue.
Yeah.
So kudos on this project, and I look forward to us making progress on that.
Councilman Scribner.
Like you said, the board recommended this, and we certainly don't have to approve it, but I think that with the city's share just being $250 on this MPO planning event, I would think it's probably something that we should move forward as well. So I would move that the MPO planning event advertising, the pink sheet and the request for that be included in the budget.
Is it not included in the budget?
I understood that it wasn't. Maybe I'm wrong.
No, $750. Okay, $750 is included in the budget.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded. Now, discussion.
You say this is not in the budget.
Correct. $750 of public involvement is included in the budget.
It says the total cost of funding is $2,500, but
yes.
But the city's portion is $250 and the county's is something less.
Councilman
Scribner,
can you restate that motion that you made?
Yeah, I'm just saying that pink sheet 182, if I'm understanding correctly, this item was presented as a pink sheet request, and it was not included. And since it was part of the plan that we approved, rather than going back to the board and asking them to fund it at this point, I am moving that the city go ahead and fund this and add it to the proposed or the changes up there to be approved at a later time.
Any other questions on this motion? Seeing none, we'll go with voice vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those against. Passes. Any other questions on this section?
Just one really briefly. Ms. McMillan, the grant-funded position, you maybe said this, but what's the length of that grant?
It's an annual grant.
So we would have to reapply each year,
correct.
We just assume we're going to get it.
Yes.
Year.
So by doing it, so this requires, it's really two planning grants. The consolidated planning grant is the usual planning grant that we get every year for the MPO. Mm-hmm. These additional services would be funded by STP, and so that would be done by a separate grant agreement that would come later. So you're going to see the consolidated planning grant agreement in September, because we have to get on the Missouri Highway and Transportation Commission's schedule.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilman Scribner.
If and thank you for asking that question. So I want a little bit more clarity, I think, as well. You're saying the planning grant that covers the consultant, but is also the planning grant that covers the MPO planner?
The consolidated planning grant agreement covers the two existing staff and the usual operations of the MPO like we've had for the last several years.
Okay.
And it would also cover this addition and the public involvement. The new program is basically the professional services and the new staff position, and that would be covered by a separate grant agreement that will come to you later.
And there's as long as the federal government wants to fund and have planning operations and wants to help fund improvements and they do it through this mechanism, those grants should be just practically automatic every year.
We hope so. All of this is funded through the Federal Transportation Act. So when you hear Congress and the, you know, on the federal level talking about not having a Transportation Act, well, this is one of the programs that it affects. Construction, obviously, also, but this is one of the programs.
Thank you.
Any other questions? All right. I guess we're ready to move on to the next section.
Thanks. So next section, 530, redevelopment and grants. The redevelopment and grants division really has two budgets. There's a 530 redevelopment and grants, and that's out of the general fund budget, and that's approximately $231,000. This division also administers the community development block grant program, and that's a federal grant, and that particular one is in your 149 account. But the 530 accounts supports four boards and commissions, basically historic preservation, the facade committee, environmental quality, and also provides staff support for the Cultural Arts Commission and the Old Town Revitalization Company. The program areas in this division are the Neighborhood and Reinvestment Act programs, the one that we work in concert with the Old Town Revitalization Company on. And also some grant administration comes out of that budget. So on the pink sheets on that division, you will see that request for a loader for glass recycling. So that one actually was funded out of the current year's budget, fiscal year 15. So we appreciate that. That's in the process of moving forward. We're getting have request for bids out right now. The other pink sheet that is included in the fiscal year 16 budget is the recycling education mailers. And what we do with that is we have annually sent a door-to-door, every door direct basically is what we use from the post office. And it's a very economical way to get information out to every household in the community. So that's what that funds. And then partially funded was an addition to the Neighborhood Reinvestment Act, the residential incentive programs. And then one pink sheet that was not funded, Historic Preservation Fund grant. There was $16,560 requested in that. That's a 60-40 grant opportunity. And what we have been doing in the past is using local match. The staff time is used as local match. So that the 60% basically funds the consultant work necessary for surveying properties like the Morrow Drive neighborhood or Forest Hill. Hazleton could be added in the future. There's also some areas of Old Munichburg that we need, would like to fill in. So one thing we could also use this for in the future is to ask for some planning assistance. As we try to find ways to supplement our planning program, we could also use it to help us with ordinance work, for example, in a historic district or creating an overlay district. So just want to plant that seed for future. You know, when additional funds become available, perhaps we can use this grant opportunity to accomplish one of those projects.
Any questions? Councilman Scribner.
So of these pink slips, pink sheets that are here, what was actually funded? The glass recycling was approved last year, but I guess it didn't get bought.
Not. We're in the process of bidding it, getting bids.
Is that in the 15 budget?
Yes.
So, what's the pink sheet doing here in the 16 budget?
We published this before. That was included in the 15 budget.
Supplemental issue.
Okay, so this is not actually been approved.
Correct. We're not requesting that anymore.
Okay, and then on the next one, the $45,000 for Old Town Neighborhood Reinvestment Act. How much of that was actually funded?
$10,000 is an additional $10,000 was added
to
this the, to the F-16 fiscal year 16 budget.
And what was it last year?
About 35.
35. So that would make it 45.
Correct.
Okay, if approved.
Yes.
Okay, and then the certified local government, none of that was included.
No.
And recycling education mailers.
That was included in this budget.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
All right, any other questions? Seeing none, we will move on to the next section.
Okay, thank you. Before we move on from this section, I just want to also tell you about the budget 149. That's the CDBG entitlement budget. As I mentioned before, this is a federal grant that the city receives every year. We use $205,000 kind of as a budget, estimated budget. But we typically get a little more than that. And this year, we just received our notification that we'll be receiving $243,075. So this will be coming to the council next week to accept the HUD grant. And it's actually, this grant is received very late in the city's budget year. So this grant is for fiscal year 15 that we just got notification on. And so that will fund about $69,000 in public improvements, which would probably most likely be mostly used for sidewalks. Homeowner support, which assists with code deficiency, energy efficiency improvements, and emergency corrections of emergency situations, such as if someone has a sewer that needs attention, about $50,000 there. $25,000 in demolition, $25,000 in down payment assistance, $25,000 to assist partner agencies with achieving common goals. And then the administration on that grant is a maximum of 20%. We estimate that will be about $48,000. So that totals up to about $243,000 in grant funds that we'll receive.
Into 15.
We're going to, it's for program year 15, which is basically January 15. Begins January 15 to December 15.
Councilman Hollis?
I thought I understood this. I'm not on that. I don't want to do some other topic. I'm done with that. Back to the Old Town Pink Sheet. They'd
asked for an increase in the Old Town. They actually wanted to double it. Mm-hmm. And that amount was $45,000, wasn't it? They ask for in the budget currently is $10,000.
Yes.
So this pink sheet here would to bring it up would be $35,000.
I think there was an addition of 10 in this budget.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's not just $10,000. They had 45 the year before. They got an additional 10. They had asked for 45 plus 45. Yeah. They'd asked for it to be doubled. So they got 45 was in there. The budget plus an additional 10 of right. So it made it 55.
Yeah.
So
okay, so this pink sheet that says 45 really is 30. Wouldn't it be 30?
Well, they were asking for an addition.
Oh, so
the
pink
budget.
Sheet is 45, but
yes,
then in
overall
the
they were
budget.
Asking for $90,000.
Yeah.
Got it.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Seeing none.
Question.
Oh. Councilwoman Ward.
So the 45 that's typically always in there is still in there, and then
yes.
We have the additional 10 grand on the parking lot, correct? Or it's in the mayor's budget?
Yeah, it's in the yes. Mayor's budget,
okay.
Correct.
If approved, it'll be a total of 55,000.
That's
right.
A correct statement, yes.
Mm-hmm. And then getting back to that grant, that 2015 grant, since it's from January to December mm-hmm. 2015, mm-hmm. when do you have to have those funds spent? By the end of the year?
Well, a lot of it, we have projects ongoing. So in November, we'll have some time to expend those funds since we just received them. So we're really not in any danger of getting into a situation as we were several years ago where we didn't have adequate projects planned and have adequate projects in the pipeline. So we have adequate projects in the pipeline, and partially due to the assistance of Department of Public Works Engineering, they're very helpful, and we work together in identifying projects, and where there are sidewalk projects or other capital improvement projects that are in low to moderate income neighborhoods, we like to partner those with community development block grant funds. Not only does it achieve the goals of the community development block grant program, it helps the city's capital improvement program funds go a little farther. So we appreciate the assistance of engineering to help get those projects planned and engineered and out on the street for bid and constructed.
Any other questions? Seeing none, we'll move on to the next section. Thanks.
Okay, next section, environmental health, section 532. Not a lot of notable changes there. We did request uniforms for the staff in that section, and that was included in the budget. That division is responsible for maintaining the cemetery, so there's some contract expense in that division. Cemetery maintenance, the compost services are the major contracts in that section.
Captain Scrivener.
Give me some clarity on the uniforms. How many employees are we talking about? How many uniforms are we talking about?
Three employees, and we're basically talking about shirts, like polo shirts and jackets.
Okay, and how many for each employee?
I think 12.
12 shirts for each employee?
Yes.
Okay, and who's responsible for laundering?
They are.
And replacement?
We will be responsible for replacing them, just, you know, normal wear and tear.
Okay.
It's important, I think, for field staff to have an identity with the city. They're going out and meeting the public and inspecting daycares, food service operations, and meeting the public. You know, for some of the staff to go out and without really an identification other than their badge, that puts them at a little disadvantage, and I think it presents a more professional image for the staff and the city as a whole to have that identification, that, you know, right off the bat, to have their city logo on their shirt and jacket.
Councilman Holovich.
Well, that brings up the question, do we use any kind of uniform companies for laundering? And
some other divisions do. I think the transit division does, and maybe police and fire probably, but I don't know for sure.
Okay.
Any These would be wash and wear.
Okay. Any other questions? Seeing none, we can move on to the next section.
Thank you. The next section, property maintenance, number 533. We have three full-time staff and one part-time staff in this division. This is responsible for handling a lot of complaints on property maintenance and nuisance. They enforce the property maintenance and nuisance code. They register landlords and keep track of vacant and abandoned buildings. This division also supports the administrative hearings for nuisances, junked vehicles, and vicious animals. And this is also a section in which we requested uniforms, and that is included in this budget, and that's probably the major change.
Councilman Scribner.
How many of these individuals are mobile in both departments, the department before and this department? How many do you have that use city vehicles?
Four.
Are they all assigned vehicles? Do they operate out of a pool, or how?
They're assigned vehicles.
They're assigned vehicles. Are they take-home vehicles?
No, they are not.
Okay. And about how many miles do they drive each year?
I don't know if I can answer that question, but I can sure.
Could you
sure
could
find
you
out.
Maybe let us know?
Yes.
I'd be curious, and maybe if you could let us know what kind of vehicles they are and how many, what year model they are.
Yeah, they're about 10 years old.
Yeah, I was just wondering.
Yes.
And I would assume they're maybe explorers or
they're
pickups.
Explorers or pickups.
Okay. Well, if you could maybe give us a list with the how many years old they are and how many miles you drive them annually. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Seeing none, we'll move on to the next section.
Building inspections. This is my last division, 534. We have four full-time staff in this division. You'll recall last year we implemented a new program. We hired a building official, and we implemented a program to cross-train the inspectors to become combination inspectors. I'm happy to report we're moving in a very good direction toward getting combination inspectors certified. They're taking training and making headway toward that goal. Our building official holds two professional licenses, and he started stakeholder meetings with the development community. And education, adding value, and coordination are really important goals that he's trying to achieve. So he'll also be discussing updates of the codes with the development community in the next few months. We like to be on a three-year cycle to update the code, but we've gotten a little behind on our code updates this year, so we might have a little bit different schedule this time. The pink sheets identified in this particular budget are uniforms, and that was included in the budget, something the building official requested but was not included in this budget was a mechanical inspector and a vehicle for a mechanical inspector.
All right, is there any questions? Councilman Holovich?
I think that some of your performance measures are really on target, and they're really good informative information. I'm not sure which one tells me if we're getting behind on inspections or not, and so those are kind of important that we're keeping in front of those, and that our builders are able to build in a timely fashion. So any time that starts to have slippage, I think these indicators really help and maybe give us some guidance. I know we're still working on those as departments and such. The one thing about your mechanical inspector, I thought we have a plumbing board and a electrical board, but we don't have a mechanical board. And I think is there some talk of having another commission or?
If the city decided to include a mechanical inspector, that might be something that would be part and parcel of doing that.
It's my understanding currently we do not have really we certify electrical workers and plumbers, but we don't certify currently mechanical
Correct.
Systems, right?
Yes.
So we can have anybody install a HVAC system that could be in the middle of electrical and plumbing and still be not in violation of code.
Right.
I think I'd be more in favor of this when we get our ordinances in shape for mm-hmm. mechanical if mm-hmm. we proceed in that direction.
The building official is reviewing the city's codes and practices and permitting systems and all of that. So I'm sure he'll have a report coming out here within the next few months that'll provide more information on what his
Councilman
opinions
Scribner.
Are.
Do we do mechanical inspections despite the fact that we don't necessarily have a certified
No.
building inspector?
Typically we do not.
So mechanical is not something that's...
No, and you know, it's a big part of a building system that's not currently permitted or inspected.
I was going to say, to do a mechanical upgrade, you don't have to have a permit.
Well, there is a mechanical code, but the city hasn't necessarily adopted the standalone mechanical code. It's adopted by reference, so in theory, the building community is supposed to follow the code, but there's no separate permit or separate inspection for the mechanical.
I was just reading in this morning's paper about St. Louis County and the fact that they're currently under revising their codes mentioned that they're actually looking at a bill being introduced to maybe back away from some of the energy efficiency standards mm-hmm. that are currently in place. I think they said that they are they're following the 2009 code, but the 2015 code is out.
Right.
Do you know what code we are on right now?
We're on 2009.
2009. So we'd be right now essentially, unless we made any individual adjustments, we'd be on the same as St. Louis County code.
Possibly. The city did not adopt the energy efficiency code either. So, and that's been a controversial code. Columbia, I think, just is in the process of looking at the 2015 code, and so that'd probably be the code that we would be looking at adopted. We would probably skip over the 2012. We're on a three-year cycle, but we're like 3 years looking at the code that's 3 years ago, if that makes sense. So we might look at adopting the 2015 code, but the building officials in the process of talking with the development community.
I think they made assertion in that article that adopting the 2015 energy standards could cost as much as $2,000 per house being constructed. Mm-hmm. So, as you might imagine, it's somewhat controversial.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Councilman Mihalovic.
I do want to applaud the efforts to staff, have new staffing in that area, and then to be looking at that. I only know that the mechanical is not there because the staff is working on that and has mentioned that in some of the meetings, as well as the need potentially, just to give everybody a heads up, that there's some permitting and some enforcement we do that it costs us more to enforce it than it does for the penalty itself. So I think as a city, it's important that we recover our cost and don't just have people willing to pay the fine because it's really nothing. So I think we ought to be looking forward in all those areas. So I applaud the efforts of staff and you in directing them such.
Thank you.
Steve.
And the reason I didn't include it in my budget recommendation was I've asked Janice, and she indicated they're working on it, is to bring together a comprehensive look of building and what's coming in the future years, in addition to how the combination inspectors may help solve some of that issue. So it's mm-hmm. want to have a comprehensive look at it, and they're working on bringing that forward.
And it does look like those combination inspectors are going to be very instrumental in helping with the workload on the inspection. So that's very positive.
Councilman Scribner.
And this is not really numbers, but I guess I'd be curious. I know you've had an ongoing dialogue with HBA and some builders and developers and so forth, and I guess maybe you could tell us, is that still underway? Is that still something that, and is it, you want to give us an update on that?
Sure. We've had one stakeholder meeting with the HBA residential developers. We have another one coming up in September. We want to keep those, keep that dialogue open and learn from each other. We definitely want to be able to add value to their process. It's very important that we work together. I think we share common goals, but it's also kind of a process of education and helping the builders understand what's actually in the code. And so the education process is important, an important component of that. So the other side of that is the commercial development side. So we're in the process of setting up a meeting with that group. So we'll be having our first meeting with them probably in September as well.
All right, any other comments, questions on this section? Or any of the sections before Janice leaves? Or go into the next section? Thank you, Ms. Mullen.
Thank you very much.
At this time, we'll move into Public Works, Ms. Marash and Smith will lead us through these sections.
Yeah, just brief statement.
Sure, go right ahead.
Yeah. Public Works, fairly large department, $20 million worth of budgets, operating budgets, and plus we layer on capital above that, but 109 employees, so we took care of three divisional budgets last time, so we have seven to go through this time, and about $10 million worth of budget here. So overall, they all are very similar to last year's and the years before budgets. There are some pink sheets in here. Pink sheet wise, we have three personnel pink sheets in Public Works, and then of course the equipment plan related pink sheets. And just real quick on those, those were very similar plan that we had back in 04, 05 years on the equipment and vehicles that basically assigned a life cycle. We look at the year, and so whatever went over the life cycle, that's what we included on the pink sheets as requests. I would say back then, we're not to the degradation of equipment that we were back then. You know, back then we were actually parking vehicles and saying, well, we're not using this one anymore, things like that. So we're not there yet, but it's kind of heading in that direction the longer you prolong, non-equipment replacement. I just wanted to throw that out there. But really, priority as we see it is our staffing, trying to keep our level of service equal to what we've been at, and just keeping our folks well trained, and here at the city, not taking other jobs. So keeping up with their benefits and salaries important to us. If I look at the budgets overall, if you have an operation budget, like say a street budget, it's about 50% personnel costs and about 50%. Chemicals and other things, items. You look at some of our admin budgets, like an engineering budget, it's 90% personnel. So you can see how the effect is there. So just a few brief opening remarks there. And I guess we can start with central maintenance. It's the first in the series here. Unless you have any general questions.
No, just go ahead and hit any highlights you'd like to hit.
Yeah. In central maintenance, I will point out this last year we deleted one position, and that was basically due to implementing a new fuel system, which we worked with our IT folks on, and our old one was pretty clunky, I guess I would say. it took a lot of administrative time, and so we were able to, with the implementation of this new system, delete a position there. So we're really happy about that, and we actually had an opening in wastewater, so that person just moved into wastewater, so it did save the general fund some money. And this one, one of the things you basically look at in central maintenance, one of the big items is the parts line item, which is general fund parts to repair equipment, whether it's a backhoe or a fire truck or a police car or whatever. That one has kind of been steadily climbing a little bit. We did have a kind of a blip in 13. It was a down blip because that was the year we kind of went back and revised our budgets and held some things back that we were repairing. So the history is a little unusual there. It looks like it's a very steep curve, but there was actually a blip down because we wanted to hold back that year, if you recall, and not repair as many things just due to the economy. Although increasing upward, as the equipment fleet ages, of course it's going to increase. And we did have one pink sheet in there for a vehicle that is basically a shop truck. So that's kind of our CM highlights. Happy to answer any questions.
Councilman Mahalovich.
Yeah, there's been a lot of discussion about the fleet and replacement of the fleet and such. And one thing that's come up in sidebar conversation is fleet management. To what degree would you say we have in place a fleet management system where we understand the cost of certain vehicles and where the vehicle costs are exceeding its value and kind of the bearing and just the overall fleet management system?
Right, we have a very good fleet management system. Britt can go into detail of it, but basically, all the equipment is tracked, and you can tell you what fixes have been implemented. Sometimes, when we look at this, if we were to get a truck, for example, one example is, might have a truck with higher mileage, but we had this one over here that's just got tons of costs associated with it, so we might actually end up swapping that one out. Something like that. But we do have a good fleet management system and a fuel system at the city. But do you want more detail? And Britt can certainly give it.
Councilman Scribner.
I have a piggyback question on that that maybe you can answer if Britt can provide detail for both of them. But does that fleet management system go across all entities? Does it, you know, the police department requests their own vehicles, the fire department requests theirs, you request yours. Is there someone who manages the fleet centrally that makes those purchase decisions or purchase requests?
No, we do not have a centralized system of fleet. What we have when we talk about our fleet management system, it's a tracking system of our maintenance, fuel cost, and expenses associated with our vehicles. It also tracks mileage, services, ensure that we're maintaining our proper services. And then as for tracking when a vehicle is expenses are getting so high, we have the best vehicle tracking system in that we have a wonderful, wonderful folks down there that use their brain and don't just repair parts. Whenever something comes up on an old piece of equipment that they don't think that, you know, that they wonder is the smart thing to replace, they raise that flag and we have a conversation. Sometimes the conversation is go ahead and put the transmission in. Sometimes the conversation is park the vehicle and we'll figure out what we've got to do. As for centralizing overall arching, deciding who, you know, the police department, which vehicles they'll replace, and the public works, which vehicles they'll replace, those decisions are at the department level.
I notice here in this front, you mentioned that you have 514 total. Well, no, that's work orders. I'm sorry. Number of vehicles and equipment in the fleet, 514. Is that what pieces of equipment that have a assigned part or assigned?
That's a piece of equipment that we're tracking. Okay. It's not necessarily a push lawnmower or a weed eater. Those are generally lumped together and not tracked individually. But it could be a backhoe, it could be a bobcat, it could be a parking scooter, a police car, a fire truck. Any piece of equipment that is deemed large enough to be tracked individually, that's what that number represents.
But it's not necessarily always rolling stock. It might be a snowplow, that attachment that attaches to a dump truck, or it might be an attachment for a tractor or something.
Not so much the snowplow itself, but a bobcat attachment would be more akin to what you're saying. It could very well be a piece of equipment. A prime example would be our paint striper is actually sets in the back of a pickup truck, but the paint striper is tracked as its own piece of equipment.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
One more. Councilor Scribner. On your pickup, describe what kind of pickup this $28,000 request, half ton, three quarter ton?
It would be a typical half ton, four wheel drive, extended cab at least pickup truck that we would use for to go out and make field snowplow blakes down in the middle of a snow fight. This is the vehicle that the mechanics go out and to work on to get it back in shape and get it back into the shop.
And is a utility bed on it, or is that just a standard pickup bed?
This one would not. We wouldn't be looking. We have one with a utility bed on it, but this one wouldn't be that one.
Okay, so this would be the kind of pickup that if there were a four-wheel drive, and I'm sure there's not, but if there were a four-wheel drive pickup somewhere in the city that were being underutilized, it would just be a standard pickup that might be used for something like that.
Very well. And in fact, what we have done, Planning of Texas Services had two vehicles that they did not need or were repurposed. One of them went to the Animal Control Division. One of them came to Public Works. They didn't get that particular vehicle, but there was a shifting. And the vehicle that this one was planning on being replaced is now a different vehicle. That vehicle that we're using still has over 100,000 miles on it, but it's in better shape than the one, as Matt was talking about. Yeah.
That's a great question, a good point. Go ahead, Britt, and just kind of, you know, Britt is kind of our, in Public Works anyway, he's kind of our lead on looking at equipment and things like that. And we also work with planning a lot as well, but a lot of times we do a lot of shifting about of vehicles based on which ones are driven most by which people. So, you know, we're looking at an inspector maybe that drives a lot more than, say, you know, Britt or somebody like that. And so we're shifting those about a lot. So that's a regular practice we go through.
Well, and that's part of the basis of my question about a centralized fleet oversight, if you will. It might. I'm not, you know, no one wants hand-me-downs. Everyone likes to have a new pair of pants once in a while rather than wearing your brother's old ones. There may be opportunities within the city, not within just the public works or whatever, to do other things like that occasionally.
And I think you do. I mean, the groups get together and they talk about the equipment and they put them all up on a big screen and they're switching and prioritizing, going through all of that. The challenge we have right now is that the demand is so much higher than the resources available.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
All right. Any other questions or comments in this section? Seeing them, we'll move on to the next one.
The next one is, Public Works Administration, which is basically myself and a couple secretaries, but it's very much the same. What the main line item in it is our fuel budget for Public Works, so it's the fuel for all of Public Works, general fund related. And Britt kind of being over that central maintenance area, he does do a lot of work in calculating that number based on a crystal ball and looking out in the future. You know, back we did this in February and we're still revising all the time, but then working with finance to put those in the budget at our best guess. Obviously fuel's a volatile item and it's something we have to go back and review through the year, and about this time in the summertime it's one of the times we do go back and look at that about July, about halfway through the year, and kind of see where we're at.
Do we have any questions in this section? Councilman Scribner?
I know we spoke at a Public Works meeting one time about the possibility seeing if there was any kind of a savings to be had by coordinating fuel purchases with the county. I know we coordinate salt purchases and other things. And is that something that we do? Do we combine our volume to try to squeeze another half cent out or something?
We actually looked at a lot of different methods in reference to purchasing of fuel, and I'm happy to report we found out we're doing the best of the systems that we looked at. There's actually a state contract that you can purchase fuel off of, and that was the first place we went to, and we actually found out that we're paying, if I remember correctly, somewhere around a nickel less a gallon doing it the
Don't
way that we're
that
doing.
Too loud, we might lose.
But our finance department does an absolutely great job in with the way it works. Is our new fuel system monitors our fuel purchases, and our staff and finance work together so that we order a large volume, so we get a full tanker of fuel, and then our finance department takes three bids. And usually within the same day, gives us those, gets that arranged for delivery that day or even the next morning. And it works very efficiently, and we're getting a very good price.
And you've got all of the new fuel equipment installed, I guess?
We're still in process in a couple of satellite locations, but the main fueling system, which is at our central maintenance division, and then also at Parks and Recreations division, are up and online.
And you're going to put one... You have one to go into the airport?
Well, Hyde Park has one, and we've actually written some purchase orders on it recently, although, you know, it's just the initial stages of getting it done. It's kind of a side job for engineering and wastewater to kind of put that together, but we have a little bit more work to do there. So we've ordered some tanks, I believe, is what our status, and then, of course, we have some controls I think we're working with IT on to basically be in the same fuel system so we can track it and keep, you know, keep track of how we go about dispensing it.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Do we have any other questions in this section? Seeing none, I guess we can move on to the next one.
All right. The next one is engineering. And basically this is one I said that basically is 90% people. If you look at the personnel service, almost 93%, I guess. And engineering-wise, basically, they're, you know, this is one of the divisions, or it does a lot of things, but one of its main tasks is implementing capital improvement plans. And so we did have some pink sheets here, one of them for an additional engineer. I've said it many times in our CIP group, we reduced that group back a couple years ago during our budget issues by 75% of its workforce. So that's, again, a level of service issue. I would like it to be better. I know there's financial difficulties in that in hiring people, but that's why we put the pink sheet back. Working with the division, I can tell we're slower to respond to various tasks, whether it's helping with surveys of this place or just our stormwater jobs we typically do in-house. And a lot of our budgets were originally built with the think mindset that we would do a lot of design in-house. So that's why we included the pink sheet again. Of course, it wouldn't be back to what it was, but it would help out a lot. The other one, I think we had a trucks in there. Let's see, I'm losing my place here in my notes. And one of those was funded, an inspection truck. But again, it goes back to that issue. You know, we've traded trucks around and had I believe this might be our survey truck is actually what it is. Got a lot of miles on it and looks good, but it's getting some wear and tear and things of that nature. So that's the one I think we funded in there. Yeah, that's kind of my highlights there.
I had a question. We have some of us talked about already. As far as the engineer goes, we have been subbing out a lot of the expenses. Is it cheaper to have one in-house as opposed to subbing it out?
Well, I think it is more straightforward to have somebody in-house, especially on a smaller project. Of course, we still do a lot of consulting contracts regardless. What we've done in this sales tax, we've kind of modified our approach. We moved a bunch of large road projects up to the front of the sales tax just by convenience, if not need to do so. And a lot of those would be subbed out. Some would, some wouldn't. But in this case, we have let consultant contracts for those. Now, what we've delayed in our sales tax is our stormwater, small jobs, things of that nature. So, you know, there'll have to be a decision point here in the next year or so whether we hire a consultant to do kind of a chunk of them, and just, you know, that just gets you less pipe in the ground, if you will. But that's kind of where we're at. We just kind of have delayed those. Now, another reason for that delay is when we do a contract with a consultant, somebody's still got to manage the consultant contract. So, and some of those small jobs, they're more intensive with the neighborhood than, say, with the our larger projects, and everyone's got an opinion about their yard and what it looks like when we're done, and rightly so. So there's a lot of that consultants don't do as well as maybe as somebody in-house, because the calls are definitely going to come back to us anyway. So we still got to manage that workload in a high degree. So,
all right, thank you. Is there any other questions on this section? Mr. Scribner.
I just want to clarify, it says funded here for the replacement vehicle for public works, but the word funded is not beside the replacement shop truck. Was it not funded?
Okay. No.
All right. I guess I was thinking that it was, but all right. Thank you.
Councilman Halovich.
It says here you have 720 miles of roads.
That's lane miles.
Yeah, lane miles. Okay.
In other words, center line, that's two, you know, one, right. You know, okay. One lane, so center line miles about 250, yes.
Okay, thanks for the clarification of that. I thought that sounded big, but it is still big.
It is.
What if we did all our resurfacing, how long would it take us under the current F and to do all that?
Well, we actually did a study. We have concrete roads and asphalt roads, so there's been some work done on that, and our GIS guys helped us with that several years ago. I think we had an intern actually do it in engineering. But anyway, we used a GIS tool to do that. And I don't recall at that time, that's when we moved our sales tax up to its current level in overlay. From 600, we doubled it to 1.2 million in this 5 years. So we have looked at that and I'm trying to remember the life cycle. We did a life cycle, I can't recall. 15 years is what we're trying to achieve, although we were kind of in there. Of course, concrete lasts longer, but it has other problems. So that, you know, concrete has typically fallen back to the in-house staff of streets to do large repairs and things like that. So, you know, that's our other pink sheet in our street department. So I think overlay, you know, we're coming up on a new sales tax. Obviously, price of oil affects that. And so we're looking at, you know, where that should be versus this last 5 years.
Somebody remind me, I remember seeing it, but I didn't remember. What percent of the sales tax currently goes to Public Works?
It's about, I want to say, is it 59, Britt? Bill. 59%. But it has a lot of things besides overlay, of course. It has matching for airport, matching for transit, sidewalks, stormwater, roads, matching with the county, all kinds of things. In the public works section, I mean.
And you mentioned that we had doubled the overlay, and we also was able to do some sidewalk repairs, and I know that you've been doing panel repairs the last couple of years. That was something we added money for. How is that progress on that program? Are we
well you on sidewalks? Projected,
what was it, like $1.2 million to right. do the whole city?
Yeah, we had done another study. I think we're still in engineering. That was one of the benefits of having more engineers. We could do more of these studies at the time. So we've done a lot of these studies in the past, but I think it was at 1.5 million-ish of repairs, and what the decision ended up being, we had $600,000 in sidewalk money, and so the council at the time said, let's do half of that for repair and half of it for new or grant matching for new and things like that. And so we got fairly far along in that, although we had, you know, some difficulties with small contractors, as you probably recall. And so then we've actually teamed up with CDBG money, and we're getting ready to replace some more here in areas. But we focused, but it wasn't, it was a long-term process. That's over a five-year period, too, by the way. So
$600,000 over five years.
$300,000 for repair.
That's right.
So, you know, you're one-fifth of the way in 5 years. So.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions? Seeing none, we'll move on to the next section.
Okay, the next section is streets. basically much the same. The items we always look at are materials and chemicals. And this one, two big items. Materials are our asphalt, rock, stone, concrete, those kind of things to repair streets and curbs. And minor sidewalk repair as well, and stormwater repair is in there as well. So that's $275,000 funded this year. We feel that's adequate compared to a couple years past. And then the chemical line item, I'll just point out, these are the two biggies, is at $360,000. We just got our bid on chemicals, our salt, for snow fighting purposes, and this will get us filled back up, have us an average winter, and we'll still have some left in the bins. Now, sometimes we have average winters, sometimes we have less than average winters. So, you know, it's always kind of mid, I think, around January-ish, or kind of when the snow starts happening, kind of revisit this issue with the council and go from there. So we feel it's adequate at this time.
Councilman Scribner?
I guess I was a little surprised to see the number be that big, because I know we appropriated some money at the end of last budget, and I thought that we maybe had put enough into stock to be able to maybe not have quite as large a number. Is the cost of salt up again this year? Is it remaining high for 2 years in a row?
It's actually moderated slightly, but certainly not back to where we'd like it to be. We did reappropriate money at the end of the last fiscal year to assist with the previous winter. But when we did that, we didn't know that we would be paying $114 a ton, which was almost double what we had been receiving, and when doubles, like 75% increase of what we had received. So that money coupled with last year's budget money, we were able to make it through the past winter and did very well. We are currently 1,000 tons below being full. So this, we've received our new bids. We had actually estimated when we did the budget back in March, $80 a ton. We just took bids. It came in the high 70s, I believe 78, 79, in that range. So we were good or we got lucky, and we based that on buying 1,000 tons to fill up and then having enough for the average winter, as Matt said.
So what's the, you know, the non-crisis, the non-outlier price, the average, that usually that you, is it, what, around $50 or so a ton? Or
Yeah, that those days are long gone, unfortunately. Gas prices, salt prices, you could almost put them right together. They do seem to go along. And then you get a year where you get a big jump, and then it goes back down a little bit, but it never seems to go all the way back down. You know, we started doing this job, when I started doing this job, we were in 40, 30s, 30s, $40 a ton. Now we're at 80. And that was about $10 to $20 what 2 years ago, more than what we were paying.
Thank you. Mr. Crowley, you have a question.
If I could just follow up on Mr. Smith's previous point, was with this increased number, based on an average winter, we're hoping that we don't need to come back to council for a supplemental appropriation. That was the intent of doing this. So now we've got a better idea of the total cost for the street piece here. So it's not like it's just a significant increase, because we're not planning on that supplemental. Doesn't mean it won't happen. Depends on the winter and everything else. But that was the thinking, at least at this point.
Any other questions?
I'll go ahead and point out in this budget, we did have pink sheets, workers, two worker street workers that get us back to our original worker total from a couple years back. Those weren't funded. And then two things that were funded were our pothole patch truck was funded, and refurbishing a snow plow, which is something we have not done in the past, so it's kind of a trial deal. We have some trucks. You want to just mention what that's about, Britt? It's kind of an interesting thing.
It is something very different that we've never attempted before. I know some other agencies have. We have some vehicles. They're 2000 models, 2001 models. We call them our snowplow only. They're a single axle, two-ton dump truck, well, without a dump bed. And we call them snowplow only because they're physically just the cabin chassis, and bolted directly to the frame is a spreader. And then they have a blade in the front. So they can only really be used for snow fighting purposes. As you might imagine, they're not extremely high mileage, but they're 15 years old and been through some of the most corrosive environments that you could imagine. So what we've talked about doing is we believe the engines and the transmissions in them are still in good shape, but the frames have got a lot of rust on it, brake lines have got some problems, and what we've put in here is a test number is 35,000. Again, we've never done this before. Is taking this, there are some companies that refurbish equipment such as this, almost like a frame off restoration, if you will. And they were hoping that we can actually extend the life of those vehicles. To replace them currently would be in the range of $110,000 to buy a new one. So by putting in a third of that or 25% of that, we're hoping to extend that life and get more use out of it and the most bang for our buck. It's just one more example of how we're trying to do more with less. And if we were flush with money, I don't know that I would be attempting this, but I think it's a good example of one way we can try to extend the life of that fleet beyond just looking at buying new.
Councilman Scribner.
I personally think it's a great idea, and I think that we ought to do it as much as we can, because if you go buy a brand new one and expose it to the corrosive environment, you're going to get the same situation that you have today. You're going to have rusted frames and rusted brake lines and everything else. So as long as mechanically the engine, transmission, and differential will do the job that you need to do, if you can just keep refurbishing it repeatedly, I don't know how long you can continue to do that, but for as long as you can, I think it makes a lot of sense.
Mr.
Even if you have to put a new seat or something in it at some point, because eventually the seats break down and floorboards rust out and things like that, but you can weld new floorboards into them too.
And I just didn't want to give the impression that just because some of these items are not included doesn't mean that they're not needed. It's just a matter of overall funding. So.
Councilman Hussey.
Just a question on the estimate of the lifespan. You say 5 years or so.
Excuse me?
The estimate by refurbishing these vehicles, you're hoping to get another 5 years out of them. Is that the goal? Is that success? And I asked the question just in this context. It's $35,000 to refurbish for 5 years, $105,000 to replace the vehicles that last 15 years. In reality,
I think it's a trial. You know, we don't really know. We're hoping at least 5 years, I guess, is the way I'd put it. Britt's done an estimate, but that's as good as probably the paper. You know, there's other people you talk to that says, you know, this is probably not the best idea, you know, and then we talk to others, of course, this is a great idea. So, you know, these particular trucks are snowplow only, which when I first started working here, I had not encountered something like this in Missouri, and I don't think Britt had either, and we thought this was a bad idea to even have these trucks. But it turned out it was a good idea, so whoever bought them was really thinking, had a good idea here. And the city's got a fleet of, what do we got, is it 12 or 10?
I think it was 11.
11 now, okay. So we got 11 of these type trucks, and they're not used for anything but snowplows. And we thought, well, can you retrofit these darn things or do something with them? And you really can't. It's almost impossible. But anyway, we do hope to, it's a trial and hope to get some life out of them. And they're a heavy enough truck, you can actually take on some bigger snows with them than like a 550, which is more like a pickup truck.
Okay. And the reason I just asked that question is the cost-benefit here is, you know, if you're back in 5 years to refurbish again for $35,000, well, we're kind of spending, I mean, it's about the same amount of money, but there's risk involved with refurbishing as opposed to just outright buying seven new vehicles that would last you 15 years again.
Yeah, I would say if you want to put the $100,000 in now, that probably is the better solution.
Well, he's right. Because, you know, you also got the electrical components. Now, some of that will get redone, but not all of it. Yet, of course, your motor, it doesn't last forever. These are 15-year-old trucks, so we're putting a significant amount of money in a 15-year-old truck. But I we're still recommending doing it because we want to try it out on at least one and see how it goes. And we'll know in a couple years if that's a good investment or not, I'd say.
Thank you.
Councilman Scribner.
Well, and the 5 years is an estimate, too. If you got 15 years out of the original brake lines and frame and so on and so forth, you may very well get 10 years out of it if the engine or transmission doesn't lay down first. But those vehicles are meant to be rebuilt. I mean, not the chassis necessarily, but the running components. So I guess gas engines aren't necessarily lend themselves to being rebuilt like a diesel would. But anyway, I think it's a good experiment and find out how it works.
All right, getting any other questions on this section? Seeing none, we will move on to the next one.
Bill,
are you going to cover these or?
No, Matt will, but just want to make sure everybody knows that we're from here, for Matt, we're going to skip down to tab 2 there, and we're going to go to the enterprise funds.
Sounds fine.
Just making sure everybody
knows where we are. Yeah, that's right. We're skipping out of general fund now.
Yep.
To some degree. Some of them have some subsidy in there, I guess.
Absolutely.
All right, go right ahead.
Not completely.
Which one?
Guess. So the next one I've got in my tab is airport.
Yeah, which would be page 283, just so everybody.
That sounds great.
Kind of knows where we're at.
So the airport, it's, again, very much the same. We did put a little extra in chemical just because of the snow fighting and the type of chemical we're now using. That's kind of the more or less the highlight there, the revenue side. It does look a little different if you look at the history, but the change is now, since past history, you're charging an administration fee. So that's about $40,000 of it in this budget, $40,000. And there were no pink sheets in airport. A little shop rate increase too in some of these budgets. After the shop rate was increased, when they put the budget together, they went back through on some of the repair items and increased for that reason.
Mr. Betts?
And the other thing that I might add is, in order to balance the budget, we reduced their subsidy by taking money from their fund balance. This is one of those subsidized funds that had a fund balance, and we reduced that. So next year, this will go back up probably to what its normal subsidy would be. So.
Do we have any questions? Councilman Scribner.
You're projecting a reduction in the number of aircraft operations. Is that anything to do with the fact that the runways closed in 15, but you're also projecting a lower number in 16?
Conservative number. I'll let you, Britt, you want to?
I think conservative is it, but we could see some echoes, I'd like to say, of the runway closure. Potentially some folks
take a little time to
come back, but we're hopeful that that's not the case, but we wanted to take a little bit more conservative approach.
Does the lower number affect our, other than the fuel flowage rate, that's the only way, and perhaps hangar leases, is there any other way that lower takeoffs and landings affect our revenue?
Only in respect, in a soft way, as related to future grant applications, et cetera. You may not look as good if your numbers are going down. That's a hard one to quantify, though, but I think the answer to your question, the way you asked it, was no, I don't believe that it does.
There's no hard cash impact.
No, there's no hard cash impact.
All right.
Okay, next one's parking. Again, it is about the same as years previous. The pink sheet that was funding it was a snowplow for the parking division. They obviously maintain our garages and all our surface lots about town and do enforcement. So let me see. I didn't really highlight anything unusual. The shop rate again increased a little bit. That's just due to changing the shop rate on our equipment repair. Any particular questions? I'd be glad to answer.
Any questions? Councilman Scribner.
On your snowplow, there's a snowplow dedicated to the parking division?
Yeah, there's actually two snowplow trucks that are dedicated for the parking division as they maintain, I believe it's 11 lots, and they also do a lot of the sidewalks around town, so they have some smaller equipment as well.
And so, obviously, you wouldn't have full-time personnel dedicated to that. What personnel drive who are the personnel drive your snowplows?
All hands on deck. There's seven and a half people in the parking division. I'm the half. It's a really bad day if you see me in a snowplow truck, but for the rest of the time, it's all seven. Those seven.
Yeah, and Steve pointed out, we have some parking lot maintenance. Again, we always try to put a little money in for maintenance items in the parking division. We used to budget actually a little different in the past, where we would we're wanting to try to get to upgrade of our garage, our main garage, and so we usually budget some funds for that. We haven't been doing that lately. We said, okay, if we get to that, and some of that was we were trying to get engineering to help us do that, and they just haven't had the time to do that. We've kind of taken that out of there, and we'll come back for a supplemental if that comes up. And in addition, we were thinking, okay, we may be trying to plan another garage or something like that. So it's kind of mingled in with that in the past. That's changed, but we do try to seal code a few lots, or chip seal, excuse me, and maintain our meters and things. That's all in this line item.
I had a question under contractual services. The rent parking lot, does that reflect it's been a decrease in expenses? Does
this
that reflect
the revenue side?
Oh, it's revenue. Okay.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you're asking on the revenue sheet or the expense sheet?
I was actually asking on the expense sheet.
Okay.
That's the housing authority.
Oh, yeah, the housing authority. Yeah.
I thought that was more like $45,000. That's only $25,000.
Oh, maybe I'm looking for that.
Yeah, let me find out where you're at here.
It's 62-620-523-030. If I can read that right. It's on page 296.
Okay, wait a minute. Parking lot rent. Rent parking lot, this one we had.
Yeah, there's no expense listed there this year. There was back in budget in 2018.
Yeah, it is the housing authority.
Right, yeah, that's we would receive revenue on it, and then we would turn around and write a check to the housing authority. Is that what you're getting?
I just thought it was more like $45,000.
Oh, we bought that lot.
We bought them out, so we don't write them the check anymore.
Right, but I thought it was more like $45,000 instead of $25,000. That's why I was asking.
It varied based on our collections, but generally it was a little higher, I thought, than that.
35,
I guess, here.
There was a budget of 25 and 15, but the last actual was 35. And what that was is we paid them 50% of the rent we received for the lots that they owned.
I know in years past, it's been several years now, but I can recall it being $60,000 some years when we were fuller.
All right. Thank you. Councilman Scribner.
I was going to ask a question about that lot. I know when we bought it, there was some conversation about improving it. Have we been making any improvements, and is there any money that's been budgeted for that purpose?
Well, we had a wall fall down from an old house, so we had to make an improvement kind of on the fly, and we did that mainly with in-house people. But anything to add to that, Bruce?
Yeah, we have some ultimate goals of improving the lot, making it more aesthetically pleasing, but at the same time we want to make sure that we don't overspend for the delivery of the potential revenue. So as the state's talked about doing some of their expansion work, et cetera, we're trying to figure out how we play in and how we marry into that. So at this point, and couple that with the fact that we don't have in-house engineers to do studies anymore, not to keep harping on that, but we may potentially be looking at a consultant study to give us some ideas of what we can do to improve it, or right now it's Matt and I working on the back of a napkin trying to figure out what the best thing to do. So we're kind of in a holding pattern, I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
Is that lot fully utilized now, or is it?
No, and that was all tied in the last couple of years anyway with the convention center proposals, things like that, and so we kind of we did chip seal it. I think when I first started here, it was gravel, and it was pretty bad. And so, and we've been acquiring the property, so now we own all the properties now there and have cleared them. But we've chip sealed it. It probably gets some minor repair, but not. We're not going to get crazy with it at this point.
Well, I was in a unrelated meeting yesterday, and office administration representative said that they are several hundred parking spaces short for the number of employees they have in the Capitol complex. Is that too far away for them to be willing to rent that space, those spaces?
They certainly do. Actually, the state does rent some spaces in that lot. I think Attorney General is a big client. Obviously we're willing to rent them to whomever would like them, and I know they realize we have some available, and I don't know what context they were saying. Maybe it's not in the right location or some other issue. They don't have the money to actually
have. Yeah, I was going to say I'd certainly encourage you to talk to them, because she was saying that employees receive several tickets a day, so it sounded to me like they would be ripe to consider some long-term parking. So, anyway.
All right, thanks. Is there any other questions on this section? I guess the last section would be transit. You want to go ahead and go through that one?
Sure.
Bill, is that correct? The last section for is it going to be transit?
Correct.
All right, thank you.
Right. On the transit side, some of the main difference between department budget and the mayor approved budget, I'll just real quick, is back to the fare increase. Back, we were putting this together. Gosh, it was at least in February when I start working with my staff to get it in, get it in a format to send it on. So we're assuming that the fare increase was going in at that time, even though it hadn't been implemented. So we kind of put several of those bumped up several of those line items throughout here because it does affect several of them. That didn't happen, so those got revised back down. So that's kind of some of the difference between the department director, I think, and the mayor approved. The subsidy, I'll just highlight some of the big items here that I kind of go to, or kind of go-to items, is listed at 1.2 plus million there. One of the reasons that's jumped, if you look at some of the history, again, charging this admin charge that kind of goes in with a subsidy and comes back out to the general fund, but that was, and this year it's $257,000. So, and I think we also zeroed out the fund balance in transit fairly closely anyway. Another one of those, since we have a subsidy. We'll say on the transit expense side, one thing we did do is, again, there's a question about uniforms, I think, and cleaning and that, and we do have those now down at transit. We are looking at, in this budget, and we're kind of stepping into this, and we're hopefully getting our shirts soon, is getting away from formal-looking uniforms and going more to the polo shirt type thing where we don't do the cleaning. I think the employees would appreciate. They our feedback is they would like that instead of the more formal uniform. I think it more patron friendly as well. And then also they do the cleaning. So overall, we save a little bit of money, although we have to buy shirts and kind of a uniform similar to parking has now. Several years ago, we went away from uniforms in like streets and things like that, where we had a cleaning service and all that, and I think it's been a good thing overall. So we're trying to do that with transit now. So a little change there coming up. Fuel, we've reduced based on our forecast for fuel, so that's changed a little bit. Vehicle maintenance, I think we're pretty good there. Our fleet is aging, and so it's going up a little bit, plus the shop rate. But we always, about this summer, we always check that out. You know, that's one of those things, you just don't know where it's going to be. Something might break down, or you know, that very unexpected, as they all do. And we did have one pink sheet in this budget, and it was just kind of trying something new. It was kind of promote transit in a different way. Maybe one idea that we had here is include some shuttling for various community events, whether it's Thursday Night Live, where if you park, you know, in a lot down here, say at City Hall, you get a shuttle up there, and you know, no real plan in place to say yes at this event or yes at 4th of July or one of those, this is what it's going to be and how it's going to be implemented. But we did throw a little money in there, and the reason being it's not a lot of money is really you're only talking about paying overtime probably to some bus drivers to work it for you and some fuel. We already own the buses and typically be after hours or may run at the same time, but it, again, you just bring in more drivers. So that helped us to defer that expense. So I think that's what we put that in there for. You know, we don't, to a high degree, advertise transit. It was just a way to maybe try something different. So that was our pink sheet. Just will point out, you know, I think Steve and myself have done a lot of looking at various transit agencies, and transit typically isn't a moneymaker, I would say. And I think Steve would agree with me on that. If you look at our memo, I think a year ago when Steve started here, I put together a bunch of information and kind of a history, and you know, I think it was in the 70s, I brought it here somewhere, but where basically the private folks quit operating transit systems and the city took it over back then, and so it's been in the city's control ever since. It's much the same way elsewhere. So that's kind of where we're at with transit. Be happy to answer your questions.
Any questions for transit? Give you a little extra. This is the last section.
That was the last one. I, you know, wastewater we did right. Last time, so that was the last.
So, all right. Well, I guess that's. You want to let Bill follow up on a few
Councilman
things.
Councilman Prather, I did want to make just one quick comment on transit that I know, and maybe the common practice is like back in February to go ahead and add in, let's say, something like a proposed increase. But and I know I've suggested it by email, but just wanted to mention that maybe next time we'll wait until it's actually passed by the council or somehow note it more tentatively, if that's at all possible. Just a suggestion to make it so that we're not really counting on that in the budget.
Councilman Scribner.
I think a number of council, for whatever reason, labored under a misconception whenever the fare increase was presented to us before. I think the it was based on a half of year revenues, and I think I thought, and others have told me they thought that $30,000 represented an entire year's revenue. And so I guess what we've come to understand is that it's that a full year of revenue would be more like $60,000. Is that correct? Or 65 in there somewhere?
Yeah, well, if you even add this up, it's more than that. Because just to clear the air on that subject was my fault as much as any, is that when we said, okay, there's going to be an increase, somebody asked, what's that bring us? Well, we wanted to be conservative in that number, not to overpromise a big number and get somewhere. So, you know, we just looked at the fare box, but there's other things that affects too. So we looked at the fare box, it's roughly, round numbers, 90,000. Increased by 50%, there's 45,000. But that doesn't happen. You got mid-year, half a year you don't get it or something, and until it's implemented, even FTA publishes documentation about a certain percent of people won't ride transit for a while. You lose ridership. So we wanted to be conservative. So we didn't say 45, we said 30. And so that's how that number came to be when we put it in the budget. And the budget was approved with that in it back in, when we approved the budget before November of that year. It was that first year budget. And then there was this implementation schedule, and I think we kept putting it off. And I think, here we come, and it's May now, several months later. And I did read a bill summary where it said I just didn't catch it when I had other people helping me prepare that, and I just didn't catch that where it said annually on there. It was just a typo mistake on my part not to catch it. But obviously, when I look at my budget here, we went back through and said, okay, if you do that, you're not only your fare box, your half fares go up, your paratransit goes up, and that's where we come up to more like, I think it's 70 or so in here if you look at a whole year. But again, very much an estimate. Hopefully conservative, could be more, could be less. And sorry I didn't correct that when we were having those discussions. It just kind of seemed like it took a life of its own by that time.
it's not intended as a criticism,
yeah.
But it was a preface to a question. If we were, as a part of this budget, if we chose to revisit that issue, could all the necessary hearings and everything be achieved that would permit that fare increase to happen by the implementation of this budget?
Probably not by the implementation, because this is November 1, and there's some strict time frames, and I can't remember what they are off the top of my head, but they're quite lengthy of advertising ahead for that hearing. And typically, like most things, we try to offer, besides the actual formal hearing, we try to offer some informational meetings. But it'd be close if you said start today, we would have to get in gear to do that, but I don't think it'd still be done by November 1, but maybe
sooner.
But
you could probably calculate
we could plan
on it being a January 1 or whatever.
Oh, yeah. if
that's
if
something that the council
passed,
would be interested in doing.
And I think that was a good comment by the mayor, is that it's not in here now. Perhaps if you pass it, or if you said it's in the budget, then we can put it in later. I don't know. That's up to Steve.
The answer to that is yes. We talked about it a year ago, and that's where we had the discussion about putting it in the fare increase in the budget for the discussion. So that's why almost a year ago, when we were preparing last year's budget this year, we had that piece in there. If we were going to do something and have that conversation, we certainly could prorate that amount. And one of the things we talked about for the implementation period is to have a number of months there for implementation, so patrons would know that that's coming. What that right number is, I don't know, 3 months, 4 months, something like that maybe.
Okay.
So there could be some planning there.
I just wanted to ask the question.
Thank you.
Okay, is there any other questions? Seeing none, we'll move on to Bill. Thank you, Mr. Moraz, Mr. Smith, for
thanks
going through that with us.
It's like basically we finished the budget book, so the only area we haven't covered is capital projects, and that's basically looking at the five-year plan for sales tax F. I can tell you that we've actually have the sheets, and I'll hand those out if the council would like a copy of them. But the plan did not change from last year to this year. We've kept the funding along the same lines. That's what you'll see in your budget books as well, is that the funding has remained the same as it has been in the past. We've moved money around to get a project ahead here and kick a project back, but we haven't had to do that with this particular capital projects line item. So we'll hand these out here real quick so you all have a copy of those.
Okay, and while we're doing that, I just wanted to let everybody know that our next meeting is going to be August 24th. We will
That's
not
correct.
Have a meeting, a budget meeting next week.
Right.
And then I believe we have another one the 27th.
Right. We have one on the 24th and one on the 27th.
So will we wrap up on the 24th as far as...
I think we're through the council's discussion at this point on the entire budget. So
okay.
We will wrap up if you guys say so. So if they're prepared to balance the budget and pass it on to the council as a whole at the council level, that's a discussion piece there. I would like to remind everyone that we will be having the GRUD hearing on Monday night. We put out quite a bit of information on that around trying to get that out. The newspaper's written an article about it as well. We'll also have the budget hearing, public hearing on the budget on Monday night, and a public hearing on property tax. Obviously, property tax cannot increase this year, it can only decrease. So, but those public hearings are this Monday, so encourage any kind of participation.
All right, Councilman Scribner.
Bill, this spreadsheet, it says project cash flow. So anything that is under the date 2012 has been spent. The same for 13, 14, 15, it's budgeted to be spent, and 16 and 17, is the money still available?
The money in 16 and 17 is the money that's hasn't been allocated. It's budgeted to be allocated in those years. What you see in 12, 13, 14, and 15 is the money that was allocated towards those projects. Whether or not it's been spent is, I would say, no on in some instances, and in other instances, yes. So okay. if it isn't spent, it just rolls year to year to get to the next project. It's similar to if you think about Adrian's Island, for instance, in sales tax. That money got allocated. It rolls each year for Adrian's Island, even though that was several years ago that money was allocated.
So there's no way to really know. I mean, for instance, just picking any one of them here, overlay program, $400,000 for fiscal year 2012. It may or may have not been $400,000 spent. It may have been $392,000 or
correct. Okay. And we do track that. I mean, it's a rather large spreadsheet, so that we keep each track. But if in that instance, an $8,000 would have rolled to the next year to be spent on the overlay program, and so they would have spent $1.2 million.
So
$8,000.
So basically, what we're going to try to do is when this sales tax is over and done, we're going to try to have spent $6 million on overlay.
That is a true statement.
And it's not so critical that it be spent in any particular year. Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Councilman Mihalovich?
Yeah, that's yours.
Back to information with regard to receiving on vehicle replacement and other, I guess, building. Do we have a schedule that we'd received in the past that I'm just not remembering right now of the assumptions built into vehicle replacement and what how many miles and all that? And then the building plan replacement is our whatever you call that, the additional capital. I don't know that I've seen that. And
yeah,
does it include the fire?
I don't know that we've ever given any given that to the council. We've shown it at several different meetings up on the board. That's the CRP plan that we've shown.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, it's...
We often go over it at the beginning, the very first meeting there, but we certainly can go.
Yeah, we can, and I can hand that out as if you'd like. I mean, it's several pages. It's where you can see kind of what vehicle is to be replaced when, those kind of things. Building works a little differently than the vehicle portion of it. In the buildings, it's just the major items, so it's not necessarily the fire type things like you're discussing. And in some instances it would be, in other instances it wouldn't. It depends on what those items would be. The major items that we're talking about are roofs, generators, high ticket items. I think the items that are typically over $25,000 to repair, HVAC systems, those kinds of things. So, and again, I can happy to print all that out and get a copy of that to the council.
As a follow-up question is, if we were to dedicate ourselves to, at least this council, to a chunk of money to do something about that long-term need, mm-hmm. I don't know when the light at the end of the tunnel is. I mean, yeah. And is it a forever need? Is it and that kind of issue? So I see a huge figure here.
Yeah.
Of $1.2 million.
Well, I would say that it is a forever need, I guess, so to speak. That's the point of the process, is that when we've looked at these things, we have vehicles that are going to – I mean, what has happened, I think what's gotten us to this situation is, I think back in the early 2000s, maybe 2004, 2005, we spent a couple million dollars on vehicles, for instance, and we had initially started kind of having a plan for a couple of years, 2006, 2007, but it slowly got, as the budget got tighter and tighter, money got reduced in that particular line item and the capital vehicle type line item, to where it became only doing a couple $100,000 a year, which was typically police vehicles. So what it is I don't think there's any way out of it, is in the fact that you have to continually look that we have this much capital vehicles or buildings that we have to maintain, so we have to put money towards that maintenance or towards replacing those vehicles over an amount of time. I think when I did the initial presentation, and I don't have it in front of me, but the general fund alone has over $8 million worth of valued vehicles. So I think the entire – and that doesn't include the fire trucks, because the fire trucks are part of the CIP plan, not part of the general fund plan at this time. So overall, I want to tell you it's $16 or $17 million worth of valued vehicles in the city. That are there. So that's the point of my point of saying, I think you have to put $1 million or something, maybe even a more significant number, towards that particular plan in order to keep up with it. So,
Councilman Scribner.
I know we've been working on sales tax G on a list. I don't know how soon that's going to be available. I don't even know how appropriate it is to be talking about it at this point, although it is part of our planning process to know what that's going to be. And I guess as I look at the list of projects and so forth that we've done, it's clear that with the exception of the fire department and something like the SWAT vehicle and things like that, typically rolling stock has not been a part of these sales tax initiatives. And yet I'm wondering, as we develop our list and as the possibility exists that maybe with MoDOT's issues, that we might, you know, one of two things happens there. Either they don't have funding to help us, and so we have to come up with more of the funding ourselves, and that puts even more pressure on this capital improvement, because now instead of funding 20% of something, we're funding 100% or maybe 50% if the county works with us. But, you know, we used to be splitting 20%, and now maybe we're splitting 100%. So that puts even more pressure here, and there's even less opportunity for rolling stock. Or what the result is that you have less MoDOT money, therefore you do less of the construction type projects, and in turn that maybe makes money available to maybe do some rolling stock. I look here, this SWAT vehicle, surely to goodness we're not going to be buying another SWAT vehicle for a long, long time, and so maybe that $250,000 represents an opportunity to consider some rolling stock for the police department in the future. So, I mean, like I say, that's planning conversation. That's not suggestion necessarily, but it's something food for thought.
And if I could, just a comment that you made previously is maybe also looking at maintenance, because that's going to be more and more of an issue for us.
Building maintenance, I think.
Whatever those issues, road maintenance as well.
Sure, road maintenance. There's always a need for money for overlay, a need for money for repairing sidewalks, a need for money to repair buildings. So, I mean, we're not going to have any shortage of things that yeah. can be, that are legitimate things to be paid for here.
All right. Looks like we're about ready to wind things up. Is there any other questions, comments? Councilman Henry.
I move to adjourn.
Second.
All right. Moved and second. All in favor.